Thank you, everyone. It's an impressive crew. I would have thought you would all be looking at your cell phones and checking on your market screens at this point in time. So this is even more testament to the interest that Argentina is creating around the world and for investors. And that's the main reason why I'm here today. We are setting the stage, not just today, but also we've got a very important event coming up in September, mid-September in Argentina, a business and investment forum that will be hosted by the Republic, and we'll have lots of invitees coming from all over the world. We want the world to know about, you know, the story that is developing in Argentina, and we want to open up and offer the opportunity that we think Argentina offers to the world at a very troubled time, as we learned last night. One mention or one thought, I mean, there's not much that we can say about Brexit right now, it's too early to tell. But one reflection that we've been dealing with ourselves in the Macri administration since we took office is that it seems to us that to the extent that there is tail risk, and there always is tail risk around the world, it's more an issue of the developed world and it's more an issue of distortions or disruptions around the developed world than it is an issue of disruptions or potential disruptions in our region, and in particular in Argentina. We don't want to get too carried away, of course. I don't want to get this close to saying that Argentina is a beacon of stability, but that's probably one way of looking at it, indeed. I mean, when you shop around and when you look around the world, business opportunities, prospective returns and so on, Argentina is this country in the world where there's a lot of value and where there's an administration that is changing things for the better as opposed to changes for the risk or for the worse that you might actually be seeing elsewhere in the world. So this is my first thought after a sleepless night. I think we were all watching what was going on, and we will be watching what is going on for the next few days. It also makes the point, you know, when we set this date, of course, we were not expecting Brexit to actually happen. We're not going to claim that, Susan. I don't think we can. But again, the idea that what Argentina offers at this juncture of the world is value in itself, and it's value also in relative terms, as I mentioned earlier. A few words of what we're doing or what we've been doing for the first 6 months in office. I think for us the first 6 months, as we've mentioned it again and again, whether the critical time where we were basically setting the groundwork and the foundations for what's next, which is the development phase. Argentina is this country that has always been eluding her opportunity to basically jump on the bandwagon of growth and of development. There's always been a reason for, you know, the growth spurts in Argentina not to be sustainable. And what we've done over the first 6 months in office was basically, as I said before, laying the groundworks such that we can start from a very good standing moving forward. And the many measures that we've taken up until now are basically in that direction. Susan was mentioning a few of those, you know, the things, basically the CEPOS. I'm sure you're all aware with that word, what CEPO is, you know, constraints, impediments to basically development and to well-functioning economy. We've had them pretty much everywhere, not just in the FX market. We also had it in the export market. We had it pretty much around the whole economy. Exporters had to ask for permission to export. Importers also had to ask for permission, at best. if not something else, to be able to access the FX market and therefore import. This was certainly a badly functioning economy that needed to be turned around as quickly as possible. So putting the macroeconomic house in order was obviously one of our key priorities. It was something we spent a lot of time at during the political campaign, to the point that we took the risk of anticipating some of the measures that we were going to actually put in place, even if we knew that some of those measures were the kind of short-run pain, long-run gain. We were absolutely transparent about, you know, why we were going to do it, how we were going to do it, and when we were going to do it. There was a lot of skepticism about the how and when, particularly the when. You know, many politicians from other parties shared our views, but were very concerned about whether, you know, we should do it that fast. Right now, I think everyone agrees that it was the right route to take. We've done the thing, as Susan mentioned, with the holdouts, which is not just the holdouts. It's basically abiding to the rule of law. It's honoring our contracts. It's honoring our debts. And honoring our debts is not just an issue with New York holdouts. It's also an issue with Argentinian pensioners. The precise bill that is right now being discussed in Congress, and also honoring the nation's debts with some of the provincial governments as well. And I mentioned this because over the last few days I've taken a few questions from the investment community, not quite a complaint, but almost complaining about the fact that how come you're now paying off your debt with the pensioners? And my thought here is, well, you know, if you really believe in the rule of law, if you really believe in meeting the Supreme Court's rulings, well, it's got to be the case not just for, you know, the New York law, but also for, and most importantly, for the Argentina law. So what we're trying to do here as we rebuild confidence is honoring our contracts across, you know, the world and across our own society. It's just so important for us that our elderly are being taken into account and are being cared and taken responsibly, and that we honor our debts with them. It's so important for us that this bill will get approved next week, almost as important as it was to get the holdout bill approved at the end of March. It seems to us that at the end of each quarter we get a massive bill approved, and this is also testament to a new era in Argentina, where from an institutional point of view, and this would be our second pillar, you know, the macroeconomic equilibrium pillar. The institutional pillar includes many things, but one of them is a completely different relationship between the executive branch, between the government and the Congress and Parliament. I've been a member of Parliament myself. Rosana, you've been a member of Parliament yourself. These were times, or those were times, where it was basically useless. Most of the times you didn't have the chance to discuss the bills. You just had to sit down there and wait for the other party to raise their hands and just approve it with no changes whatsoever. As you all know, we've got no majorities in either chamber. For most people, that was a problem. For us, that was an opportunity. And the opportunity is that we can now show the world that it was not just Macri and his team, it was not just, you know, the fatigue from the previous regime. It's something completely new that it's coming up in Argentina. It's something that we can go to Congress, we can modify 80% of the articles of our original bill. It can still stick to the philosophy of what we wanted to do. And more importantly, it's no longer just ours. It belongs to the people, because we've gone through Congress and we've done the right thing. President Macri has governed the city of Buenos Aires exactly this way for 8 years. He never actually had a majority in the legislature of the city of Buenos Aires, and still he was able to approve the things that that needed to be approved. And he also vetoed a few regulations, as he's done also at a national level with what we thought was a very inconvenient labor bill that would have that would have delayed the sort of investments that we are seeking for, both at home and abroad. The institutional pillar and the institutional element of what we're doing includes, of course, telling ourselves and the world the truth. I mean, stop cheating, for instance, with the National Statistics Institute, which is something the previous administration was so fond on, and which was such a huge problem, not just for, you know, for investors, but for ourselves. I mean, for a number of years, we did not have a clue what was actually going on. This was an administration that, you know, not only cheated with probably every single indicator, but they also had to give up in terms of, you know, showing a poverty indicator that we don't have and that we will recover from September onwards. And by then, will we know, you know, what's the starting point for our big promise during the political campaign, which is do as much as we can to make sure that as we move along, we are in the track, on the track, and in the direction towards zero poverty. It's not going to take just one mandate, but you need to get started, and we are getting started right now, and we're going to have the numbers to track the progress that we're making around that promise as well. So it's the macroeconomic imbalances that we've been dealing with. It's the institutional imbalances that we are dealing with. And now I think we've come to a stage where, to the extent that we rebuild credibility, to the extent that we erase, you know, the impediments for investment to create jobs, at the end of the day, the reason why we are calling for investments is basically because we need more jobs, we need better jobs, and this is the only way we will be able to, you know, move forward reducing poverty, as President Macri has actually promised more than once. And this is the reason why we are, you know, having, and Susan, you are hosting this event, and this is why we're so happy that you're offering us the platform. We think the dirty job is mostly done. We had budgeted ourselves the first 6 months in office to do that. We knew this was the time when we had the political capital to be spent, and President Macri is very courageous to actually spend that political capital for a good reason. And we also think that the results are starting to, you know, come into place. I know people are concerned about, you know, inflation, and there are very good reasons for, you know, most people, particularly, you know, the middle class and the lower class in Argentina, to be concerned about the increase in prices that that we've seen in the first few months of our administration. We would have preferred not to, but there was no way out. Essentially, what we decided to do was to stop the exercise of the previous administration, which was an exercise of repressing inflation, hoping that at some point something would happen. That didn't happen, the good way or the bad way. So we had to take the horn by the bulls, the bull by the horns, rather. I didn't say balls, though, but I was this close. a round of applause will help, yeah? So that was basically the decision. You know, the year-on-year inflation at a national level moved from around 30% where we took it to around 40-42% right now. 8 points of those 12 points are basically the direct and indirect impact of the utility price increase. It would have been great not to have had that increase, but if we didn't have it, then we would not have had energy or transport or any of the things that go attached to the prices and to the tariffs. We were very careful, and this is our third pillar, to take very good care of, you know, the most vulnerable. With the tariff increase, we also came up with a tarifa social, with a social tariff. with the other element of repressed inflation, which was correcting the FX gap. And when I say correcting the FX gap, what happened was what we were expecting. The contado con liqui, or the parallel exchange rate, fell. The official rate went up. That had some implications price-wise. But we are correcting that with another bill that was approved unanimously in both chambers in Congress, which is a VAT rebate to 20% of the most needy. And this will mean that if we succeed in the tarifa social, and if we succeed in implementing this VAT rebate to the most vulnerable, essentially we will have spared this 20 or 25% of the population from the inevitable impact of, you know, sincering, if you will, the repressed inflation from the previous administration. We are expecting the, by the way, we published our first CPI index of this administration, which is the first true CPI index in, what, 8 years or so. We are expecting inflation this month to have been with, you know, a two handle, around between 2 and 2.5%. Most analysts looking at Argentina are expecting monthly inflation to fall to around 1.5% towards the end of the year. 1.5% towards the end of the year in annualized terms is already within our targets for next year. So to the extent that you care about inflation expectations, what we can say already is that they are starting to get anchored around our targets, the flip side of which would be, well, they're starting to believe in our program. On the fiscal side, our program has been gradual because there's no other way out. As I mentioned before, we've got the political constraint of not having majority in either chamber. And we've got the social constraint that we inherited a situation whereby more than 30% of our co-nationals are living under the poverty line. So there was no room for, you know, fiscal aggressiveness. We were very open about this, and we came out with a gradual fiscal program for the whole of the mandate, with a target of 4.8% of primary deficit of GDP this year, 3.3% for next year, 1.8 for the following year, and around, you know, half a point of GDP by the end of the mandate. Just, you know, for the sake of comparisons, what we're shooting for next year is more or less where Chile is right now. And I think everyone would be very happy to say, whoa, Argentina is fiscally responsible as Chile is right now. So that is the program going forward. Looking at the economy, we see that we are clearly at an inflection point. There are sectors of the economy that are already doing really well. There are some sectors that keep doing really bad. This is usually the X-ray of an economy that is in an inflection point. Green shoots are, you know, spreading. There is massive enthusiasm in the interior of the country when it comes to the agricultural sector and the sowing season, and the potential output for next year is very high. And therefore, you know, that is also working according to plan. We knew we could not stop the growth inertia from, or lack thereof, from the previous administration with a steep recession in the second half of the year, of the last year, but, you know, and we knew that inertia would bring us into, you know, negative territory in the first half of this year. But we're very confident that in the second half of the year, many of the decisions that we've already taken will finally brew. And there, it's not just, you know, it's not wishful thinking when we say inflation will fall, the economy will start recovering. It's more the conviction of our forecast that this is actually already happening, even if it's not that visible just yet. Moving into next year, that is exactly what the electoral doctor would have ordered. There was no electoral doctrine, but we thought this was the right thing to do in any event. We've got a very important year next year for us, which is midterm elections. We are shooting for getting majority in the lower chamber, and for that we need to work very hard in that regard. But we're confident that with what we've done so far, we've set the groundworks for that to actually happen. Susan is telling me I've got to circle up a little bit. But this is where you guys come into play. I mean, this is where, you know, I'm so thrilled that you came over. We need your investment as much as we need our local businessmen investment. Investment and exports will be the engines of our development program. In as much as we get investment and exports, we'll get more and better jobs. And once we get more and better jobs, we'll get also the consumption engine working. I think the big question mark for Argentina over the last few years is, can these guys achieve sustainable growth? And when you talk about sustainable, it's not just politically, socially, and economically sustainable. And this is essentially the coherence of what we're putting together. And I think during the first 6 months of our administration, we've pushed away a few fears when people said, well, how are you going to manage the country with the trade unions against you? It's not been a problem. How are you going to manage the country with, no majorities in Congress? Well, you've seen it already. So my final thought here is hurry up, because the train has already left the station. Thank you very much.
I would now like Larry Fink, Chairman and CEO of BlackRock, to come up on stage and start his conversation with Alfonso.
Thank you, Susan. Good morning, everyone. Mr. Minister, good morning. So I want to give a context about my conversation, obviously the context of a Brexit. I think whether it's Brexit or what may happen in the Spanish election on this weekend, on Sunday, the Austrian election that we had a few weeks ago, the political realities of the United States with a very strong candidate with Bernie Sanders, and we have Donald Trump. I think all of this is a reflection of anger. And I think the anger, conventional wisdom has been wrong and misinterpreting this anger. And I said earlier in another meeting that I think we're misrepresenting, because we don't see rioting on the street anymore related to this anger. But you do now see digital rioting. If you pay attention to some of the media feeds, the social media feeds, you could read some of the anger that people have had, and obviously voted that way, and conventional wisdom was wrong again. I want to put that in the context of Argentina, because I do believe there are democracies and there are countries that are actually trying to arrest the anger and build a better future. And I think what the Macri government has done in just a six-month period of time has really, obviously 6 months, so it's not a long-term record yet, but in the first 6 months has really shown what a government can do if it is focusing on trying to change the future of its country and changing the future of its population. And so even a day today where the financial markets are in pretty much chaos, I believe we're going to see more and more examples of government who are going to take hold of this anger and address it. And as always an optimist, I will say there could be silver linings in all this. Obviously, we don't see it yet, but hopefully in the next week or two or a few weeks, we'll see silver linings in all this. But today is about a change in direction, and that change in direction in Argentina. And so that's the context of what I think we're here about. And Alfonso's presentation really did describe much of the changes within Argentina. And it's very clear that Argentina, because of past governments, was an isolated country, capital markets were not functioning, foreign capital was running away, and as you could see in a very short period of time with a debt issue, that if you have a government that is challenging what was considered that could not be done, especially in Argentina, we could see that bold government can change the future. So I wanted to put that in the context of a miserable day this morning. And there is hope in the world, and hopefully Europe looks to Argentina as a mechanism, as a way of rebuilding confidence and focusing on the Europeans and their future needs and trying to arrest their anger. So let me just take that context, Alfonso, and ask the question. What is happening in the streets of Argentina? Can you describe, do people recognize what you and the Macri government have done? Is there a sense of optimism in the street?
Well, thank you. Thank you, Larry, for being here. It's an honor for me and for your first thought about what's going on around the world. I mean, you mentioned the word anger. Anger that is, you know, asking for change. And I think to some extent, and connecting it to your question, this was actually what happened last year in Argentina. It was massive change that the voter asked for, even if many of those voters were on social programs. It was not enough for them to be on a social program because it was quite obvious for them that that was a roof. A glass ceiling that would not allow them to progress. Otherwise, you cannot quite possibly explain how President Macri won the elections. I mean, there was anger against the failure of yet another populist exercise in Argentina. And this is the hope that we hope to incarnate going mm-hmm. forward. So essentially, you know, what we see right now in the streets and in the public opinion, of course, the opinions are still very divided, and this is not unlike the rest of the world. You know, we need to get used to elections that get won by 2 or 3 points. Mm-hmm. That was the case of Brexit. It was our case as well. President Macri is very aware that one of, you know, the main challenges that we've got going forward is to unify that division. And we think we're making progress in that direction. We've been very clear and transparent about, you know, the heavy cleaning that we had to do in the first few months. What we've done was basically what we had been promising during the campaign. So even if for, you know, a part of the population, they've got to endure the side effects of some of the decisions that we've taken. Mm-hmm. The sense that we get is that hope is still there. You look at, you know, for instance, confidence surveys by Universidad Itela, and it's very clear. You see that, you know, their personal situation of those who are being polled has actually fallen in the first few months. But their expectations about the long-run situation of the country have stayed incredibly high, probably, you know, the highest they've ever been for a long time. So it's this kind of, you know, we need to connect the short run with the medium run. And the sense that we get is that most people are patient and are very aware that there's no such thing as a long run, a successful long run, if we don't deal with the legacy, the horrible legacy that we got from the previous administration. And the reason why they know that is because they voted against that, and they voted in favor of this, basically.
But if you scan the blogs of Argentina, would you see less what I call digital rioting?
Well, I think digital rioting is the order of the day, you know, isn't it? I mean, you don't get too hooked up with Twitter, because otherwise, you know,
you'll be, we'll all be depressed.
Yeah. But now, as I said before, you know, there is still division. I mean, there is still division. There was one difficulty that we found was that when we took office, there were all the ingredients of your typical Argentinian economic, financial, and social crisis were there, but the crisis itself. So the challenge that we took on very early on was to defuse the many, you know, bombs that were left around the minefield, and it was hard. It was harder to do it without any of those actually, you know, exploding beforehand, which had been the case for other administrations in the past. So basically, it's very important for us to communicate what was the route Argentina was going to through or to if we didn't take the measures that we actually taken. And I think President Macri was very clear about this when a couple of months ago he said, well, if had we not taken the decisions that we've already taken, we would have gone in the direction of Venezuela. Mm-hmm. And I think that needs no further explanation.
Is that known now with the populace? Is there a rise of consumption? Or are you seeing indication that that the populace believes we're on the right path now and that they're showing that through consumption?
They're showing that through the opinion polls, not quite yet through consumption, because some of the changes that needed to be made have been disruptive in the short run.
Right.
What we're seeing is that finally local businessmen are finally buying into the idea. So are foreign investors. I mean, we keep track of the announcements that are big enough to make it to the press. Over the last 6 months, we've got $22 billion worth of mm-hmm. investment announcements, both from local and foreign companies. There are even bigger announcements, but for the very long run, which we're not putting into this list. So I think it's, you know, it's obviously mixed feelings within a very divided society. But there's also the, and I must mention this, there's also the quite obvious corruption behavior of the previous administration
right.
that's surfaced in a way that we wouldn't have thought was actually possible. I mean, a guy found at 4 a.m. in the morning, you know, throwing bags full of money around the wall of a convent, of all places, right. you know. It's not something that, you know, even a movie director would have thought of.
It's going to become a movie.
It will eventually. But the sad thing is that it's not a movie.
Yeah.
And it's not the only example. So we're seeing lots of those examples, and people are finally realizing that how fake and how corrupt the previous yeah. exercise had been.
So you mentioned, obviously, the international bond markets have really opened their arms to Argentina. You mentioned new corporate investments. So let me ask a little more definitive question, though. Are you seeing corporations that have left re-enter? Many of the companies that were there probably could not get out. So I guess it's a two-pronged question. Are you seeing new companies coming back or new companies entering for the first time? And are you seeing the companies that were stuck, are they investing more now?
Yeah, we're seeing a lot of interest from companies and from countries that had basically lost faith in Argentina for good. We're also seeing companies that had stayed put, you know, through the hard days, very ready to deploy whatever resources they've been hoarding, waiting for better opportunities. In fact, I think the first movers of the investment cycle that we're shooting for are the multinational companies that were not allowed to, you know, repatriate their earnings, and therefore they didn't know what to do with them in Argentina. They were certainly not investing, because there were lots of uncertainties. But these have been the first movers, and you see it pretty much across all sectors and across the country. So that's actually happening. It's too early to tell, basically. But if I were to judge by the interest that I've seen since our, you know, Davos appearance, and, you know, throughout the different fora that we've been going to over the last 6 months, it's pretty much interest from all over the world. I mean, and that includes the Middle East, that was never too active in Argentina to start with. That includes many Italian names that were so afraid of coming back to Argentina during the last 10 years and now are seriously considering it. The French, well, I could go on and on. You know.
Well, when you tell me Repsol's back, then we know Everett's, you know, we know it's...
Repsol had a great deal, by the way, Larry. I mean, they got paid out.
They got paid out
even more than what
they
the...
probably...
What the,
yeah. But on the other hand, if they come back to me, that's a big sign too, though, you know, as one company.
Yeah, one thing, though, is that, you know, we are... Of course, the energy sector is one sector that... it's probably the sector with the most potential...
Within the country. Yes.
It's infrastructure and energy that we are basically focusing on. Just for the audience to know, we've just had two auctions on the energy sector.
Yes.
One on traditional energy, the other one on renewables. And just as with the global bonds that we issued a few months ago, it was six times oversubscribed. Right. So it's not just, you know, portfolio investment. These are local and foreign investors who are willing to, you know, basically dig billions of dollars for, you know, the next 20 years. And there's no question that that's a very good sign of confidence.
Well, I think the devaluation of the currency that you allowed, also now the investors are coming back and looking at the opportunities for more longer term outcomes.
Of course. I mean, one risk area that I don't know if you were going to ask me, Larry, is what's going on in Brazil. You know.
Well, I was going to move there. But before we talk about Brazil, let's get into the need for infrastructure. Can you tell the audience, what are you looking for? What do you think is going to be necessary to, in terms of foreign capital, to help build this better future for Argentina?
Yeah, I mean, I think the way you should look at Argentina right now is this is a massively under-leveraged, under-invested economy. Of course, those two go together. You know. The extent to which Argentina has ceased to invest, both at the public and the private level, is the unleveraged situation that we can see both at the sovereign and at the corporate level. You know, Argentina's corporate debt with respect to GDP is around 15%.
Right.
That compares to 60% for Latin America, a bit more than that for Brazil, like 100% for emerging markets, and that includes China, of course. But, you know, why not including China in that comparison? So essentially the idea here is that this is an economy that has ceased to invest over the last 5 years. And the flip side of that is that, you know, once we get the investment engine started again, that will create a boon, we hope so. You look from a macroeconomic point of view, fixed investment as a percentage of GDP is less than 20%. There's no way any country in the world can grow more than 3 or 4% with so low a ratio of investment.
Right.
We need to increase that ratio at least 6 points of GDP. We would be very happy to do it from the fiscal side if we had the resources to do it, but we don't. Even still, we will be dedicating around 2 points worth of, you know, public works spending to increase that ratio.
It'll go to what level? If you had 2%?
Right now, from 2.5 to 4.5. But obviously the rest of the effort will have to come from the private sector. We've got a federal agency of investments that is basically, you know, touring around the world and around the country for spotting the different opportunities. This is why we're doing the event that we're doing in September. But essentially, when you look at, you know, the big numbers, we think that, you know, the low-hanging fruit of investment in sectors like infrastructure and energy probably will require those two by themselves a good $150 billion of investments. Of course, one, and then we can go beyond those two sectors, you know, agricultural sector, tourism. There's pretty much everything to be done on the tourism industry, software. We've got the natural resources. We've got the human resources that stand out certainly in the region and probably even beyond the region. So that's basically the opportunities there. All we need to do is make sure that if you invest, you're not going to be told what to do and what not to. And once you make the money that you make out of that investment, you'll be able to do with that money whatever you want. Throughout the process, of course, there's going to be a state that will be checking on you and making sure that you abide to the laws and to the regulations. But you know, it won't be mingling with whether your, you know, corporate decision goes mm-hmm. this way or the other way.
So you brought up Brazil, but let me put it in the context of the Americas for a second. So it is our opinion that the Americas are among the best places in the world to invest in, whether it is Canada or Mexico or Colombia and historically Chile, and then we have Brazil. We all see the great opportunity. And yet we've been, you know, entirely disappointed. And yet now they're on a path possibly to rebuild from their failings and from a prior government. What does a strengthening Brazil mean to Argentina? And two, let me probably, I don't want to be presumptuous, maybe you don't think it's going to strengthen. So what is your view of Brazil at this moment? And how is the economic interchange between Argentina and Brazil? And I'd like to also hear from related to Chile and Peru and Colombia.
Well, I'll tell you first what a weak Brazil means for Argentina before we get into the discussion of whether it's strengthening or not. It's a back-to-back recession in Brazil. We all know that, you know, and it's a very steep one in that. Something Brazil has not had for, you know, like 70 years or so. 15, yeah. Only once in a generation or more than one generation. That is clearly having a very heavy toll on Argentina's economy, and in particular in some sectors that depend excessively on Brazilian demand. You know, the obvious place to look at is the auto sector, but it's not just the auto sector, it's regional economies, particularly in the northern part of the country, that depend almost entirely on Brazilian demand, that are suffering and that are requiring some effort on our side, from the government side, to alleviate whatever pain they're going through. We've calculated that three and a half type of recession, a continued recession in Brazil, probably knocks off around a point worth of our GDP, if not a point and a half. So essentially Brazil today means that Brazil is the difference between growing and not growing for our first year in the administration. So it's really critical what's going on in Brazil today. We all hope that, you know, what's going on right now is basically a strengthening of the situation and an improvement of the situation going forward. Of course, we can't quite make that call because there are some political decisions and there are some, you know, uncertainties going forward. One thing you can say, though, off the hat, is that the strengthening of the Brazilian real over the last couple of months has actually helped to alleviate the strengthening pressure that we've seen in the peso, more broadly speaking. As for the rest of the region, and starting, of course, within Mercosur, which is Brazil and Argentina, and also Paraguay, and Uruguay, and Bolivia, and Venezuela as well, even if Venezuela has not been too careful about meeting the different, you know, requirements to be part of Mercosur. But essentially, our thought about integrating Argentina with the rest of the world starts in our neighborhood. We need to reinforce Mercosur as much as we can. We take this as an opportunity to, you know, strengthen our relationship with Brazil and with our neighbors We've exchanged offers with the European Union, between Mercosur and European Union, whatever that is right now, with the idea of, you know, improving our markets, our global markets going forward. And we also, if we make that happen, the agreement with the European Union, it's going to be very reasonable and very sensible to think about uniting Mercosur with Alianza del Pacifico.
Yes.
This is where your Peru and Chile question comes into play. But we think there are, particularly with Chile, lots of economic and cultural ties that have been kind of disconnected over the last few years. And of course, Chile is not the only case in point. But we are working towards, you know, rebuilding, despite the finals that we're having this weekend.
We're going to ask you about
We're working on rebuilding that relationship as well.
Good. Are you going to the game?
I am not. No, I'm flying back tonight. Sadly so.
So let us open it up for questions. And please identify who you are. And can you stand, because we can't see you.
I'm trying to hide in here.
It's a packed house, isn't it?
It is. It's wonderful. Carolina Costa with McClary Associates. We are a Washington, D.C.-based consulting firm, and we work with a number of investors in Argentina. Thank you so much for your remarks. Very, very great. The question I have is the point you made with regards to the Argentine and the Brazil relationship, particularly on trade. You highlighted the auto sector. Next week, there is a possibility that the auto trade deal will expire. It's our understanding that the two countries are now negotiating for that because it could cause a trade disruption for a sector that's very important to both nations. If you can comment on that, thank you.
Yeah, we are negotiating the expiring agreement between the two sectors and the two countries. Of course, these agreements can always be extended, so there's that opportunity as well, which is probably the most likely outcome going forward. We've just signed an auto deal with Colombia, and we are renegotiating our auto deal with Mexico as well. So I think you should look at it in the broader context of not just, you know, Argentina and Brazil within Mercosur, but actually beyond that. And a further thought in that regard or in that line is, again, an important element of the legacy that we've inherited, which is the following. You know that the previous administration was very keen on putting barriers, non-trade barriers, to, you know, imports in most of the sectors, non-automatic barriers, basically. And since these barriers were built so consistently along so many years, it was only natural to expect from our neighbors to retaliate. And retaliation we did get from, you know, our neighbors, but in particular from Brazil. So our discussion with Brazil right now is, now that we've removed these barriers, we would really appreciate if you could follow the same example and do the same thing. So the negotiation with Brazil right now, even within Mercosur, goes way beyond the auto sector. And this is where, I mean, the auto sector is important for us. But I would argue that the other, you know, retaliation type of measures that are refraining our, you know, small producers in Argentina to sell into Brazil are probably more important for us at this point in time than the auto problems.
Anthony, we should get a microphone so people.
Thanks, Alfonso. Thank you very much for your comments. You made an allusion or the lessons learned from the lack of growth in the Brazil case, but may I ask your thoughts about the lessons learned from the Mexican case, where there was a lot of enthusiasm, some of which has tempered off a little bit. But in regard to Argentina, what were the lessons that you draw from their experiences, and how do you anticipate dealing with those?
Thank you, Anthony. I mean, yesterday I had a very interesting conversation with someone here in New York, and he was explaining to me something I was not aware of, which is, you know, the evolution of unit labor costs in Mexico with respect to some obvious trading competitors, including China. And the reflection was that 5 years ago, Mexico's unit labor costs were like 25% higher than what they were in China. And right now they are like 15% lower.
Well, with a 19 or 18 peso to the dollar, it's lower now.
So, I mean, the lesson that I would draw from Mexico is that we need to improve in our competitiveness in Argentina. And we need to do it through, you know, not lower wages, but actually higher wages. And for that, we need to improve on the productivity front. And there's only that much that the private sector and the private companies can do. I think the onus there is a lot more on our side, on the public sector. Whatever productivity gain that you are able to achieve going forward, we believe it's going to be like 70% our responsibility and 30% the private sector's responsibility. If we move along the lines that we've already mentioned, you know, energy, infrastructure, connecting, you know, wisely the different regions of our country and not just building a dam or building a bridge only because, you know, the governor of that area was good with me, kind of thing. If we have a strategic plan around how we're going to be dealing with infrastructure going forward, if from the public sector we're not in for, you know, basically stealing the money, as has been the case many times with public officials, but rather to make sure that the public monies are really put to work in that regard, I think, you know, most of the work will have been done. But essentially, you know, there's a competitiveness quest for Argentina right now. We can learn the lessons from other countries, Mexico and Chile, for instance, in that regard. We want to move away from the discussion of competitiveness being just a discussion around the currency. It's a lot more complex and complicated than that. And this is where I think, you know, we can, I don't think Mexico is just, you know, the peso. I think Mexico has done
a
lot more than the peso. And by the way, it was trading above 19 today, so we shouldn't talk too much about the peso today. Right. But I think it goes way beyond that. And I think, you know, the president has lost a little bit of the wind in his sails. But some of the things he did at the very beginning, you know, asking the opposition and coming around, you know, the Mexican pact and so forth, are ideas that we could probably test ourselves and put to work.
Time for one more question. Please, over here.
Thank you. Daniel Volberg from Lord Abbott, an investment management company. I have two questions, if I may. So the first question...
Can he ask two questions, Larry?
We'll see how long they are.
Okay.
The first question is, you know, if you look at the evolution of public sector in Argentina, the tax take is at, you know, record highs by Argentine historical standards, almost 50% of GDP, and it's one of the highest in the emerging world. So as you look forward, how do you think about managing that issue? Do you think that the government should be shrunk over time, or is it more about sort of efficiently using the tax revenues that you guys are now collecting? And put that in context of your fiscal targets, which are, you know, for substantial deficits over the next few years, reduction in deficits, but still substantial deficits, given this, you know, very high tax take in Argentina. And then the second question maybe is, I don't know if you'll answer it.
First one was too long already, Larry, wasn't it?
And the second question is...
We'll see if we'll listen to this one.
If you look at the, you know, the performance of the Argentine peso. You know, do you see sort of a need to make things more flexible or not, in the sense that, you know, there's been some restrictions still. You know, for example, we saw the central bank reduce access to central bank paper.
Actually, I don't think I understood the second question, so that leaves...
The first one.
Because there's no restriction whatsoever for, you know, new flows, so there's no problem with that.
If I may clarify, it's the euro-clearable paper.
Well, I mean, that's not about... I mean, you're complaining because you can't make as much money as you were making out of these Lebac papers. I mean, let's put it, you know, white over black or the other way around. I'm not aware that there are too many central banks in the world that offer short-run paper. And in fact, the central bank will move on to an inflation targeting regime, a formal inflation targeting regime. And by the time the central bank gets there, you know, Lebacs will be part of history. In fact, I had a lot to do with the Lebac market when I was at the central bank. And the reason why we came up with this market was because there was no sovereign debt market to speak of, because the country was in default. The only way to, you know, get involved in open market operations was through new central bank paper that was not there and that needed to be there for, you know, the curve to be drawn and so forth. Given that we're no longer in default and given that we're moving towards an inflation targeting regime, well, you know, the thought there is obvious, and I don't think anyone should complain about the fact that they can no longer make a lot of money out of Lebacs. They might as well, you know, make more money out of FDI, for instance. That would be my advice in that regard. As for the fiscal question, first thing is, you know, just don't get carried away. The numbers are not as high as 50 percent of the tax take. If they were 50, we would not be running a deficit. So be careful what you want to wish for in that regard. The numbers are more like close to 40%. But there again, I think we need to be more thoughtful. I mean, the last time I addressed an audience like this one in a capacity of a public servant, like 12 years ago, I was governor of the central bank. The questions in that regard went the exact opposite way. Hey, Argentina is always having a problem because you don't collect enough taxes. So you can't quite complain because we collect too few or we collect too much. Essentially, my thought here is that we're starting off from a much better situation on the fiscal side than in any other experience in the past, because the toughest element or the toughest lever of the fiscal policy, which is the income side, is where, you know, I don't know if it's where we would like it to be, but it's a good starting point. So if we are wise and if we are efficient in dealing with the excess spending, then most of the equation will actually be solved. When I speak about excess spending, I'm speaking about public works that were overpriced by more than 30 or 40% in the previous administration. I don't think it's a good way of using the public funds, no matter how big the tax take is, to just, you know, throw the money around convents and putting it below, you know, the altar of whatever convent there is or there might be out there, which we haven't as of yet found. So essentially the idea is you tackle down corruption and you stop giving away paychecks to the rich, which is basically the subsidy policy of the previous administration. And you say that, you know, our fiscal deficit numbers are very high. I'm not too sure that that's the case on a relative basis, but still 4.8% of GDP this year. And that includes still 3 points worth of GDP of subsidies, most of which are still going where they shouldn't go. We're going to increase the social tariff, and we think that by the time the social tariff is catering to the amount of people that we want to cater, the subsidy bill will not need to be higher than 1 point of GDP. So just, you know, stopping the corruption and stopping giving checks away to the rich. And when I say giving checks away to the rich, we've made studies about this. And in fact, the Scioli economic team made some studies about this, and they found that 50% of the subsidy bill ended up in the pockets of the 30% richest of the population. So it's a completely different ballgame from anything that you've seen in Argentina in the past. In any other experience, the dilemma was where to cut, and wherever you had to cut, it was going to be painful. I don't think it's going to be painful to cut at the level of the richest 30%, but I'm open to suggestions.
Well, I think we heard today why many of us believe that there's a turnaround in Argentina, and a day like today with Brexit and all the instabilities. We have a finance minister who is forward-thinking and a government that is looking to build a better future. And I think what Alfonso and his response has only reconfirmed, I think, the market's view. So, Alfonso, thank you. And I know we have many more sessions later today.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Susan.